that matters to me. The only one whose favor I see. Father smiling on me, the only name that matters to me. Yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, power that forgave me.
Treat this morning. I'm preaching today. Alrighty.
Yay!
Thank you. So I want to thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you for being here, and thank you to those who are watching online as well. We look forward to worshiping God together and hearing from His Word this morning. A few announcements. First, if you're a visitor, or if you're newer to our church, and you want to get in contact with us, please feel free to fill out one of the connection cards you can find in the gathering place. You can also use those cards to share prayer requests or ask for information from us. And then we have Glens Valley Elementary School needs volunteer tutors for ages, I believe, second to fourth grade. And that will be taking place at the school on Thursdays or Tuesdays. And if you'll be interested in helping, please sign up in the gathering place. There's a sign-up sheet out there. They also want to let you know that volunteers will need to do a background check on their website through their newsletter. And it'll be from Tuesdays from 10:15 a.m. to 12, starting on October 26th after fall break. And if you have any questions, just ask Debbie Truex. Also, we have a pickleball tournament going on this afternoon. So it's going to be the second pickleball tournament, and it's going to be from 5 to approximately 7 o'clock. And Julie Corbin and Travis Huntsman are the defending champions. And so we want to invite you to bring out your lawn chair or something to sit on and come enjoy some world-class competition. Our outreach committee plans to reach out to help pressing needs for our Afghan refugees. So we invite you to purchase new items from the list provided. And donations can be dropped off in the gathering place today for the following two Sundays. I believe that's all we have. Our scripture from today comes from Romans chapter 4, starting in verse 4. Paul says, "Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one whom God counts as righteousness apart from works, blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin." Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this beautiful day you've given to us, this gorgeous weekend and the fall weather that's come in. We thank you for this morning that we have to worship you and to be with you this morning and to hear from your word, Lord. Thank you for everyone who's come together to listen to me. Lord, I pray that you bear with them and be with me and strengthen me this morning. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Caleb, for getting things started. Won't you please stand with us, if you would?
King of kings, yeah, you were, and now you're.
has us in his care. His word, his promises are true. Amen. Yes, they are. God good this morning? If we ever feel distant from him, it is probably not his fault. I know in my case it's not his fault. So the praise team gets a kick out of when I pick a song from like the 90s. This song is beautiful. It's called Jesus, Lover of My Soul. And it's going to get our minds ready for prayer time. He loves his sons and daughters. There's nothing that can separate. Nothing that can separate. There's no hurt that he can't comfort. I know there's places in your life that God has been good to you, and I know that there's places where you wonder where he was. And all of us have experienced a week. It might be a mountain, it might be a valley. And Jesus cries with us, and he laughs with us at all the right times. Amen? So he's in this room. We're going to have a conversation with him, each of us in our own way. Let's do that now for the next few moments. We have a God that listens to us and that loves us. sitting at your feet, Lord. And this might be the first time this week that we said hi to you, good morning, that we even recognize that you are there, care about us, love us. Draw us close to you, not just this morning, but in the times when we need you most, in the times when there's loss in our lives, comfort us. When there's joy, Lord, walk those mountains with us, those mountaintops. Those who are away today, we pray that you just keep them safe and bring them home safely to us. Give them rest. Rejuvenate. Revive. While looking to you for that revival, Lord. We can't thank you enough, Jesus, for being obedient to your Father and going to the cross for us. There is salvation through you, Jesus, through your blood. Help us to be faithful. We ask, Lord, the provision that you give us, that we would be able to give back with our hearts, and that you would use that to further your kingdom around this broken world. We love you, Lord, lift you up, and we praise you in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Leading into the message this morning, Caleb is going to bring the message to you, and this song came out of a heart that loves God. And pretty song. Enjoy. Like David in the temple, I want to bring you praise. Like David and his temple plans, your ways are not my ways. You don't need me to build a temple to know that you love me still. Oh, oh, oh. Like Israel on the shore, all I see is crashing waves. But like Israel on the shore, it's through the wild you make a way. Oh, I will go where you go. I will stay where you stay. Oh, 'cause I don't wanna go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me. Desert, I want to see the land, but like Moses in the desert, I can't fully see your plan. Still, your love doesn't stop when I see the land from a mountaintop. Oh. Like Peter on the hill, my face like me.
I will go where you go. I will stay where you stay.
Thank you, guys. Well, good morning again. Oh, I'm so glad to be up here preaching to you guys this morning. I'm excited. I hope you guys are excited. I hope that song moved you. It's a song I recently came across, probably maybe a year ago, and I thought it just fit with this message so well. So I hope you remember the lyrics as you leave today. The song is called I Don't Want to Go, if you want to look it up. So, this morning we're looking into the story of the Israelites crossing the Red Sea, and that's in Exodus chapter 14, if you want to go ahead and flip there. Our main idea of the message today is choosing to glorify God. So that's going to be the focus of our whole message. Many people rightly say that love in a marriage isn't a feeling, it's a choice. It's a choice you have to make every single day in the marriage. And I think the same is true with glorifying God in our relationship with Him, because it doesn't always come naturally. We have to choose to glorify God with every decision that we face. So this morning we're going to unpack some ways that we can do that. First, I want to tell you a story about myself. So as many of you know, I'm the youth pastor here at CCML, part-time. But I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of you didn't know that I have another job in Avon. I work for a water company called Aqua Systems. And I deliver water jugs and salt for water softeners in a big delivery truck. And I drive around downtown every day. It's a really good job. I really like it. I like my bosses, and it gives Mariah and I, you know, a comfortable wage and everything like that. Recently, though, I felt that the Lord has called me to leave Aqua Systems and find a job that's part-time, at least, that allows me to spend more time and energy on my ministry, which is my higher priority. And a few weeks ago, I agreed with God. I was under a large workload. We were in the middle of the summer, which is our busy season. And we were short-handed, and so I was ready to start job hunting as soon as I found the time. But as the summer ended and things slowed down, I found myself comfortable at Aqua Systems again, and I still have a lot of friendships there. So my desire to leave has stagnated, but I still feel that God is telling me that it's time. So a few weeks ago, I bucked up my determination. I applied for some new jobs, but my heart wasn't quite in it. I found myself dwelling on all the worldly responsibilities that I have, like school payments or saving for a house and such. And I also found myself just worrying about bills and finances in general for no real reason. And I just started questioning the idea altogether, saying things like, why right now, God? And, you know, what comes next? What's the plan after? And I'm not sure if I want to jump into this if I don't, you know the whole layout and you haven't showed me everything that I need to know. But about a month ago, the Lord brought me to the story I'm about to read to you this morning. As I read it, I realized that the questions and doubts that I had been worried about sounded a lot like the questions and the statements that were troubling the Israelites as they stood on the shore of the Red Sea. And maybe these are questions that you've struggled with in the past, or maybe you're struggling with them right now. So I want to read it to you this morning. Exodus chapter 14, starting in verse 1. We're going to go through the whole chapter this morning, but we're going to break it up into two parts. So we're going to read down to verse 14, starting verse 1. Then the Lord said to Moses, tell the people of Israel to turn back and encamp in front of Pi-Hahiroth between Midgol and the sea, in front of Baal-Zephon, and you shall encamp facing it by the sea. For Pharaoh will say of the people of Israel, they are wandering in the land, the wilderness has shut them in, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them, and I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his host, and the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. And they did so. When the king of Egypt was told that the people had fled, the mind of Pharaoh and his servants was changed towards the people, and they said, what is this we have done that we have let Israel go from serving us? So he made ready his chariot and took his army with him, and he took 600 chosen chariots and all the other chariots of Egypt with officers over all of them. And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued the people of Israel while the people were going out defiantly. The Egyptians pursued them, all of Pharaoh's horses and chariots and his horsemen and his army. And he overtook them and camped by the sea, by Pi-Hahiroth in front of Baal-Zephon. When Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them, and they feared greatly. And the people of Israel cried to the Lord. They said to Moses, is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us in bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not what we said to you in Egypt? Leave us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians rather than to die in the wilderness. And Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. The Egyptians whom you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be silent. So let's take a pause right there. So through my whole life, the questions and doubts that the Israelites exclaimed to God in this story seemed so ridiculous to me as I read it through my upbringing over and over again. I just I couldn't wrap my mind around how they could be so unfaithful after God had done so much for them. But this time, when I read it just about a month ago, the questions didn't just sound ridiculous. They still sounded ridiculous, but they also sounded familiar, which made me feel a little bit ridiculous. My worrying had brought me to questioning God's leadership in a very similar way. And we find the Israelites so silly for questioning God like they do, especially because we know the end of the story. You know, for them, they had no idea what was going to happen next. And making them look silly is partially the reason it was written this way. So it shows the Israelites' lack of faith and, you know, maybe makes them look a little bit foolish, but the point of it was not to mock them, but rather to help future generations learn from them. And that includes us. And of course, that includes me as well. So what do we do differently? Well, let's read again what Moses says to his people. Verse 13, Moses said to the people, "Fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be silent." Okay, so some things Moses said, fear not, stand firm, and the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be silent. And through that, I heard the Lord speaking more in kind of modern language. Stop worrying, stop fussing about, you don't have to do a thing. Just follow me and I will take care of you. And then that reminded me of something that Jesus said in his Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 6. Jesus says, "So do not worry saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." Why is it that despite decades of faithfulness to us, many of us, including myself, obviously, are still so afraid to sacrifice even a single thing to follow God's leadership, even when we know we've known our whole lives that he's always good to us? I've never gone hungry a day in my life. I've never had to miss a meal that I didn't want to, and I rarely fast anyways. I've always had a bed and a house to sleep in. I've never had to sleep in the cold unless I was on a camping trip or something like that. I have every reason to believe that God will provide for me, but I'm still afraid. So this morning I want you to think about, what are you afraid of and what's holding you back from God's leadership? Because God could use you right now in the world that we've been given today to do glorious things for his name more than ever. But are you willing to do it? Will you live in fear or will you live in God's courage? God can empower you to do great things, but he will not force you to do them. That has to be your choice. The Israelites were ready to choose slavery over freedom. So let's think about, what will you choose to do this morning? Hopefully the Lord can use me to persuade you towards glorifying him through obedience, wherever he's prodded your heart to do that. So let's keep reading. Let's pick up in verse 15. And we're going to read to the end of the chapter. The Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Lift up your staffs and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the people of Israel may go through the sea on dry ground. And I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they shall go in after them. And I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his hosts and his chariots and his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gotten glory over Pharaoh and his chariots and his horsemen." Then the angel of God, who was going before the host of Israel, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from before them and stood behind them, coming between the hosts of Egypt and the hosts of Israel. And there was the cloud and the darkness, and it lit up the night without one coming near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove back the sea by a strong east wind all night and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the people of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went in after them into the midst of the sea. All of Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, his horsemen. And in the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and of cloud looked down on the Egyptian forces and threw them into a panic, clogging their chariot wheels so that they drove heavily. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from before Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may come back upon the Egyptians." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to its normal course when the morning appeared. And as the Egyptians fled into it, the Lord threw the Egyptians into the midst of the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen, all the hosts of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea. Not one of them remained. But the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. And Israel saw the great power of the Lord and how he used it against the Egyptians. And so the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. That is an incredible, inspiring story, one of my favorites in all of Scripture, which is why I wanted, also another reason I wanted to share it with you today. Well, now that you've heard it fresh in your minds, I want to ask you a few questions to get you to think and respond to this story. So first question, think about, you don't have to answer this out loud, think about, what is this story all about, okay? And don't think, like I'm not asking for the order of events. I'm asking, what's the purpose of this story? Why did God do this? What are we supposed to learn, and how are we supposed to respond? So what is this story all about? Well, there's many ways people often interpret Scripture to figure out a takeaway or an application. But for the purpose of this message today, I want to talk about three ways people most often interpret Scripture. The first one I like to call the miracle-minded approach. Okay, so with this approach, someone might take to heart the powerful miracle that God performs in this story or in another story. And they might say, "Wow, that's incredible. God is so powerful and he's so good. He literally split an ocean in half for the people that he loves." And I'm going to be encouraged by that because I know that God's able to split the seas of my problems in life and allow me to walk straight through them. And I also know that he's in my corner because he said he's going to fight for me and he's going to protect me from my enemies, whether that be Satan or an actual person. And so that's one way to take it. And the response that, or the takeaway might be, so this means that the church should not question God in our trials, and we should have faith and pray to God to save us from those trials, right? And that's probably something that sounds familiar to all, which is good, by the way. All those things are true of God. God is able to do anything with our trials, anything that he likes to. He can take them away, or he can add more onto them. He can do anything. And he's likely done things that we see in this passage for people every day since the beginning, where he's decided to, they pray to him, they cry out to him, and he's taken it away for them. We never want to have the cold tendency to say, like, God could take all my problems away, but he probably won't. No, we want to share the attitude of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, which was, and this is a paraphrase, "I wholeheartedly believe that God can save me from this, but even if he doesn't, I will glorify God." Okay? But again, that's the miracle-minded approach. It's only one option for interpreting this story. And it's not the only lesson I think we can glean from this story. So if I talk about the next approach, I like to call it the gospel-minded approach. It's one of my favorites. So with this method, the goal is to point out all the theological dots that connect with the larger scripture or picture of Scripture, and the gospel especially. The main focus for this story then would be the theological significance of God moving the waters for his people's salvation. And the scripture, actually, this story outright uses the word salvation in verse 13, if you noticed. Verse 13, Moses said to the people, "Fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will do for you today." It's an interesting choice of word. And so you might point out that the entire scene of God splitting the waters in half is a metaphorical picture of the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ. So God, by his own hand, is saving his people from their great enemy who wishes to enslave them and destroy them. And therefore, God provides a gateway through the waters for their salvation. And it's no coincidence that Jesus calls himself the gateway to eternal life in John chapter 10. And then once the Israelites have been saved, God uses the very same tool that saved his people to completely crush their enemy. And this is, of course, is an allusion to how God promised Adam and Eve that he would crush the serpent's head through his son Jesus in Genesis chapter 3. So you could say, if you want to keep going with this, verse 31 would be our takeaway, which says, Israel saw the great power that the Lord used against the Egyptians, so the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. So you could say our takeaway or our response to the story is to believe in God and to believe in his son, Jesus Christ. In other words, the takeaway would be that questioning God's provision to us is unfounded because God has already given us the greatest provision that we could ever ask for, which is our eternal salvation. In other words, the takeaway is the gospel. This, again, is an excellent way to interpret the passage. I do it very often. And there's no doubt that God orchestrated this story to foreshadow the coming of Jesus. But I think a third approach might be most appropriate for this passage and probably most of Scripture as well. I call it the glory-minded approach. And through it, I want to combine the previous two approaches together, but shift the focus a little bit. Let me walk you through that. The two previous takeaways or the applications to the story were, I think, a smidge off of what God is trying to draw out of us in this story. So the first takeaway was to believe that God can save us from our problems on earth, and the second takeaway was to believe that God has saved us from our eternal problem. But I think that one thing this passage makes abundantly clear is that God is not doing all of this just to save the Israelites. The story isn't all about them. He had another purpose in mind. So let me read to you verses 4 and verses 15 to 18 again. Verse 4, God says, I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them, and I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his host, and the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. And then skip to verse 15. The Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it. The people of Israel may go through the sea on dry ground, and I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they shall go in after them, and I will get glory over Pharaoh and all of his host and chariots and his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gotten glory over Pharaoh, his chariots, and his horsemen. He says it twice there in that passage. So you didn't catch it. God's main purpose to everything he does and everything he does in this story is to glorify himself. So our response to the story then should be to glorify God. So how do we do that? That's what we're going to talk about in this last slide. I wrote down these points up there for you as a summary of our application. And I want to start first with how Israel chose to glorify God in this story. So let's pick it up one more time in verse 31. Israel saw the great power that the Lord used against the Egyptians, so the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. So the Israelites glorified God by believing in him and turning their fear of man into fear of God. That's how they chose to glorify God in this story. Some of us here, including myself, have been more afraid of the world than we are of God. Like the servant in Jesus' parable, if you remember, the servant that chose to bury his master's money rather than to invest it. Some of us have remained frozen in fear and worry, and we disregard the Lord's prodding in our hearts to run straight into those uncharted waters, if you will. A while back, I asked you all what was holding you back. Some of you in this room have felt the Lord prompting you to make a sacrifice for his glory, and He's given you this story, like he did for me, to remind you that your life isn't all about you. It's about glorifying him. When God opened up the Red Sea, he did not force the Israelites to walk through it. They could have chosen to see the waters and chosen to stay out of fear of the water crushing them. They could have been frozen in fear by the exact same thing that God was trying to use to save them, but they didn't. They believed in God, and they followed his leadership, and he saved them from their slavery as a result. So this week, I want you to consider where God is leading you and what choices you need to make to glorify him. So this could mean a small act of obedience in your life, or it could mean a huge rededication to following Christ. Both would glorify him. It could mean taking time to pray for someone or sharing the gospel with someone at work or at home or at school. It could mean following God into the mission field for a week or a month or perhaps even your whole life. But for me, I will be following him towards whatever job he leads me to next, and I will pray for the faith that he will meet my needs, whatever they may be. And that's how I plan to glorify God here in the near future. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your scripture. We thank you for your word. And we really thank you for this story that you've given to us, this beautiful picture of you and the Father's love that he has for us. Lord, I pray that you would give us courage and strengthen us during this difficult, scary time where we don't know what's coming up next and we don't know what to trust, Lord. And sometimes we forget that we can trust you and everything. Be with us, Lord. Again, give us courage and allow us to follow you wherever you are prodding our hearts to go. Allow us to make sacrifices. Allow us to give things away that we know that we can live without. We love you, Lord. Be with us this week. Amen. Alrighty. We have a few classes, 11 o'clock still. The youth will be meeting, and stick around for that. And thank you. Have a great week.